Flare On is a series of reverse engineering challenges by FireEye because they want to find and hire smart individuals interested in reverse engineering. So, if you need a job, just contact me and I sell you the solutions. Just kidding. I don't know yet how far I will get, as reverse engineering can be quite time consuming and I believe many challenges are based on Windows, which is not really my world. Anyway, the game is simple. Analyze the sample, find the key. Each key looks like an email address and ends with @flare-on.com. Enter the key for each challenge in the Flare On CTF app to unlock the next challenge. And oh boy, did I get mad at this browser terminal. Dot dot slash didn't work, ls, which is supposed to list files, just showed text, and even having moved with cd into a directory, you could just move away. Literally unplayable. So let's look at the first challenge, Minesweeper Championship Registration. Welcome to the 5th annual Flare On Challenge. The Minesweeper World Championship is coming soon and we found the registration app. You weren't officially invited, but if you can figure out what the code is, you can probably get in anyway. Good luck! And here we can download the file. When you unpack the 7-zip archive with the password infected, you will get a .jar file. I'm 100% sure that the first challenge will be just the most basic thing ever, so I just immediately used JD GUI, which is a Java decompiler, and right here in the main method, you find that the string is compared to the email goldenticket2018@flareon.com. So this is our first flag. Let's copy it into the form and submit the flag. Correct. Cool. We solved the first challenge. So let's not waste any time and move on to the next one, Ultimate Minesweeper. You hacked your way into Minesweeper Championship. Good job. Now it's time to compete. Here's the Ultimate Minesweeper binary. Beat it, win the championship, and we will move you onto greater challenges. Again, we get a 7-zip archive with the binary to download. This time we got an exe file. I assume because it's still just a second challenge that it's still super simple. So I immediately opened the disassembler IDA, I'm using the version 7 freeware here, to analyze the exe. But right here, when we select how to load the file, IDA saw that the binary seems to be a .NET assembly binary. And if you would instruct IDA to assume it's just a regular PE compiled binary, then it looks empty. That's because this is a .NET binary. Like I said, I'm really not that experienced with Windows, though of course over the years you pick up stuff here and there, so I know that .NET programs are not compiled down to regular x86 Intel CPU machine code, but it's compiled to an intermediate language and the decompilation of that is super nice with tools like ILSpy. So we can open the binary in there. Ultimate Minesweeper. At first I was just clicking around, I didn't even execute the binary yet, I have no clue if we actually have to play something. But the code doesn't look too large and I was just trying to get a feeling of what is implemented here. And of course you quickly see names such as success pop-up or failure pop-up and the minefield and so forth. And I immediately went for the success pop-up, what else would I look at? So this class has some texts as labels, a picture and a text box. The initialize component initializes those components. But also things like the text, congratulations, you have won the Ultimate Minesweeper Championship. And nobody cares, here's your prize. But no flag here. Is it maybe displayed as an image? Does the image contain the flag? So I was looking for that image resource, but I only found these balloons. Also the other pictures do not have a flag. But when checking the success pop-up constructor, which takes a key as parameter, you can see that it's assigned to the text box 1. And that happens after the other components were initialized. So that key is very likely the flag. So where does the key come from? With right click on the method name we can select analyze, which opens up this tree structure below, and here we can check where this function is used. So it's used inside the squared revealed callback of the main form. This method takes a column and a row integer and checks if a bomb was revealed. So sounds like typical Minesweeper. In case a bomb was revealed, we would get the failure pop-up and exit. But if that didn't happen, then we see that a number is calculated based on the row and column and then added to, I guess, a list or array of revealed cells. So every time you didn't uncover a bump, the number of the cell, which can be calculated by the row times v alloc node limit plus column? Well, so that variable name is weird. The calculation would make sense if it were row times the amount of cells per row plus the column. This way you just number each cell. So the fact that the cells per row values appears to be called the alloc node limit seems a bit odd, and thus I think it's meant to add a little bit of obfuscation or confusion. So in any way, we add the correct revealed cells to this array, and if there are none unrevealed left, we create the success pop-up with the key generated by getKey, which gets the revealed cells array. So let's check out that method. First of all, we sort the array of revealed cells. Then random is initialized with an integer calculated based on the first, second, third, based on the first three revealed cell numbers. And initializing random like that means this is setting the seed value of the random number generator. In case you don't know, pseudo number generators require a seed, basically an initial value, and based on that the random numbers are generated. So using the same seed produces the same random values. So the creator of this challenge knows exactly which cells are the correct cells, and thus the integer that is calculated here will always be the same. So the random number generator will always generate the same numbers, at least as long as you revealed the correct cells. This randomness can be easily attacked, but I explain that in a second. Let's quickly finish that code first. So here a big byte array is initialized with seemingly random data, and then a second byte array is filled with random bytes from the random number generator. After that, we find the loop that is XORing both these arrays together, and these bytes encoded as ASCII is returned. So that XOR decryption should reveal the key. So basically, we have here an encrypted flag, and the key is dynamically generated through a pseudo-random number generator that requires the correct seed, and the correct seed requires the correct revealed cells. But there is a weakness. First of all, the seed definitely is a 32-bit integer, and 32-bit integers are not that huge. They go from minus 2 billion to 2 billion. So only 4 billion options that are possible here, which means we can just brute force all 4 billion options until we decrypt this byte array to the flag, which we know ends with @flareon.com. But we can even optimize the brute force further, because we know that the seed is calculated based on the three revealed cells, which are also sorted right before. So this means the first cell must be the smallest number, the second cell must be larger than that, and the third even larger. So these are already good constraints. And on top of that, based on the calculation we have seen before, we can try to find what the maximum amount for a cell even is. This vAlloc node limit number appears to be 30, and also the minefield is initialized with a size, and this one is also the vAlloc node limit. So that means that the maximum number of for row and column is like 30 or 31 or 29. You know, computer science is complicated. I'm not exactly sure if the first cell here started with 0 or 1 in the callback handle of the click, whatever. It doesn't make the brute force worse. But now we have even more constraints. This means we can now just copy and paste the getKey function and wrap it into some loops to try out all possible numbers for first, second, and third cell. And here's the code. We have three loops, each loop is responsible for one cell. So A is the first, B the second, and C the third possible revealed cell. And the max value for each of them is 30 times 30, that's the Minesweeper grid size. And also because the revealed cells are sorted, we know that B must be larger than A always, so we can always start B being one larger than A, and the same is true for C, C being at least one larger than B. So that brute force, checking if the decrypted byte string contains flareon.com, takes maybe 5 minutes. Super quick, easy peasy. But then I was surprised. When the brute force reached the end and didn't find anything, what the heck? That doesn't make any sense. That really confused me. So at some point, I even just brute forced all possible 4 billion integer values for the seed and still didn't find it. That was so weird. So I went back into the decompiler and tried to find what the correct cells are. So I looked a bit around and found this two-dimensional array, so the Minesweeper grid called minesPresent. It's Boolean true or false, so that probably tells us if there's a mine or not. And with the analyze feature, we can again look for where this is used. Let's see where the get method is used, so where it reads this value. And there is this garbage collect array, which also has mines present bool true or false. And that one is used by allocate memory, which gets passed in a minefield. And that one has two loops going from 0 to valloc node limit, which we know is the grid size 30. So just because these names like allocate memory, garbage collect, valloc, node limit, blah blah mean something, it's really confusing to read the code. They refer to very different concepts in computer science, but the names are fooling us. We know that the two-dimensional array variable garbage collect also has mine present, and this flag can be true or false and is assigned to it. So this loop goes over the whole 30 times 30 grid and decides based on this obscure if statement using derive valloc type if a particular cell has a mine or not. And that weird function takes R and C, which is just row and column obviously, and does a calculation on it and flipping the bits and then checks if that result is contained in valloc types. So it's just to throw us off and obfuscate the cells that have and don't have a mine. But we don't get fooled. We also don't really have to invert those valloc types and figure out the row and column. We can just copy and paste the whole code again, make sure that we get all the important numbers, and then we simply print when we would set false, so when the mine is not present. And when we run that, we find three cells where there shouldn't be a mine. And now we can execute the game. Here it is, and count the cells and rows and find the cells. 1, 2, and 3, and we win. Here's the flag, cheaters always win at flareon.com. But I'm still confused, why our brute force didn't work? But now that we know the exact three cells that are correct, we can test our code. We can just hard code A, B, and C based on the rows and columns we got. And otherwise, the code is the same. Seed the random number generator, generate the XOR key, XOR the bytes.
Oh, I get it. I'm so dumb. Okay, so I had this whole ending prepared where I showed that even hard coding the seed in a loop didn't really work and it was alternating the flag and garbage. And I didn't find my bug when I did the challenge. I also didn't find it when I prepared the script for the video and didn't see it when I edited this part. Only now, in my second round of editing where I draw my overlays, it clicked. I'm so dumb. The encrypted flag array2 is initialized once and the XOR operation is modifying those bytes. So in the next loop round, we now have garbage in that array2 and it's not the encrypted flag anymore. Thus, my brute force failed. By initializing array2 in each loop, it works.